Ruth Coppinger, please.
Thanks again, Carla. And Taoiseach, you might mention when you're thanking the parties who support the referendum, parties like Solidarity, People for Profit and others in this Dáil who brought repeal bills here, whose members haven't voted down repeal bills and whose members aren't out campaigning against repeal. So, Taoiseach, in 48 hours, people will have begun voting at the referendum on the Eighth Amendment. And would you agree with me that this is one of the most important votes in decades in this country? It's obviously about abortion, but it's also about the status of women and about the type of society that we want. And for the past 2 months, we got a glimpse of what the No campaign think of women. Spreading lies and half-truths, whipping up fear, in fact, spreading out-and-out misogyny is their stock and trade. In the No campaign HQ, they meet each morning, they rub their chins and they wonder, is there anything to be said for another misogynistic poster? How about one suggesting that women will flock to have abortions once it's made legal? How about another suggesting women will go through a physically painful procedure as their regular form of contraception? And even though we know late abortions happen in the rarest and tragic circumstances, let's suggest that women will actually hang on for 6 months of pregnancy, which is obviously a cakewalk, then suddenly decide they want an abortion on demand. Now, the message behind these type of posters is thinly veiled misogyny, and it's aimed at sending out this idea that instead of being intelligent and equal beings who are highly responsible, women are actually the nurturers and carers of children, of sick people, of old people, but yet they want to demonise women and present us as a threat. And Taoiseach, do you agree that the question needs to be posed to voters about what type of Ireland do you want? Do you want one advocated by the yes side, where women are listened to, not silenced and forced abroad? Or should the nation be reminded of what a no vote actually would mean? Because as well as saying no to the right of a woman to have a choice, the leaders of the No campaign have said no to contraception, they've said no to sex education, they said no to same-sex marriage 3 years ago, to divorce, to equal employment, to married women being in the public service, to working mothers, to LGBT plus rights, to gender recognition, and I really don't have time to go on. And does anyone think that if they somehow snatch a victory against the tide on Friday, that they wouldn't seek to impose a ban on the right to travel, a ban on the right to information, and the 14-year jail sentence that's faced by 5 people using abortion pills each day? Now, I'm hopeful the yes vote will be delivered by a youth and gender quake on Friday, by the thousands who I see campaigning on the ground, and by the 120,000 mainly young people who registered to vote, which is twice the marriage equality rate, and by the women and men on the doors who've reflected back their lived experience of reality of life now.
Taoiseach.
I just want to add to what I said earlier by acknowledging the role of smaller parties and indeed independents in this particular campaign, whether it's Greens or Social Democrats or others, parties of the left as well. And as regards my constituency colleague, Deputy Coppinger, I want to particularly recognise her early role in putting this matter on the political agenda and raising it in this House, perhaps at a time when many of us would have preferred not to deal with it. And I think it's only right that now this question is being put to people to acknowledge the early role of Deputy Coppinger and Deputy Daly and others in that regard. In terms of the women of Ireland today, there are roughly 60,000 births in Ireland every year, which means at this moment in time, there must be about 40,000 women in Ireland who are pregnant, and I absolutely agree with you. I do not believe for a second that there are 40,000 women in Ireland who are pregnant today, that one of them is walking around today waiting to decide on whether or not she's going to continue that pregnancy based on the decision that we make on Friday or Saturday. I can't imagine any of those 40,000 women saying, if there's a yes vote, I'm going to have an abortion, if there's a no vote, I won't. That's not how it works. Women who feel they need to end their pregnancies will do so anyway, but they do so in a dangerous way, whether it's by importing the abortion pill online or whether it's not in a dangerous way, but in a higher risk way, travelling overseas to end their pregnancies, often much later in their pregnancies than they would if they're able to access those services here in Ireland. In terms of what Ireland do we want, I think a yes vote says that we want to have a more compassionate Ireland, a more caring Ireland, one that helps people, helps women in particular in a time of crisis. I think it says that we accept the reality of abortion that already exists in Ireland and that we're going to manage it and regulate it here. But I also want to say to people who are worried about this, and there are a lot of people who are worried about this, this decision, there are a lot of people who are going to vote no and will vote no in clear conscience. I want those no voters to know that if there is a yes vote this weekend, that Ireland will still be the same country as it was before. It'll just be a little bit more compassionate.
I think in the debate last night we saw just how backward and reactionary the no side is. And I just want to say that there are some people in this Dáil who claim to love both, but they weren't shown too much love in several debates in this Dáil. So, for example, one of the deputies in 2010 in a debate on social welfare talked about the elephant in the room, the considerable number of young women, and I quote, many of whom are still teenagers, who consider them single parenthood a choice, which can be financially rewarding, and who talks about people having babies outside of committed relationships and how this must end. It's Deputy McGrath. And about the idea of people using having children as an escape from poverty. I mean, this kind of stuff, that's how much they love both. And all of the guff that we heard in 1983 about how they were going to help people. But I just want to finish by mentioning one inaccuracy I think needs to be corrected, and that is in relation to the abortion pill. Five people are estimated to use these pills in Ireland if you base on two of the websites, Women on Web and Women Help Women. And I think we should be accurate and not scare people about the pills. The pills are very safe. There is medical supervision in that there is a doctor-led service. Doctors who stepped in when doctors in Ireland wouldn't, it should be acknowledged. But obviously the real danger is the fact that the law prevents people from seeking any help in the 3% of cases where they may need follow-up. And I'm proud to have promoted the abortion pills with Rosa and others.
Thank you, Deputy.
Described as safe by the World Health Organization, and I think we should be accurate about that.
Taoiseach, to conclude, please.
I think that they may well be safe, but when it comes to any medicine that's bought online, you can't always be sure that it is what it says it is. And obviously there are legal consequences too, but I think we all agree that it would be safer if they were legal and available here in Ireland. I think there's two aspects of this conversation, this debate, that perhaps haven't got the recognition or notice that they deserve. First of all, abortion rates in Ireland are falling. The number of women who travel overseas to end their pregnancies, giving an Irish dress, has actually been falling in the past number of years. And that's a good thing. That's something to be welcomed. And also, teenage pregnancies in Ireland are at their lowest since the 1950s. And I think we do need to ask ourselves why that is. And that is because of funding provided to groups like the Rape Crisis Centres, to Crisis Pregnancy Agency. It's because of sex education in our schools. It's because of the wider availability of contraception. It's because of the availability of the morning after pill. And these are all changes and reforms that have happened in the past 10 or 20 years that have reduced the number of crisis pregnancies, reduced the number of abortions, reduced the number of teenage pregnancies. And I do think there is a certain irony in the fact that those who are most opposed to this change that we're proposing, those who are so convinced that a no vote is the right thing to do, that they are actually very often the same people who opposed the morning after pill, opposed contraception, opposed sex education, opposed all the things that have actually made abortions less common in the past number of years. And one thing I do want to say to people, because there's one thing I think everyone agrees, whether you're on the yes side or the no side, is that we should continue in our efforts, no matter what the result of the weekend, that we should continue in our efforts to reduce the number of crisis pregnancies in the first place. And that will mean delivering on our commitment, implementing the recommendations made by the All Party Committee to make contraception more available, to improve sex education in our schools, so that we can continue to see a fall in the number of crisis pregnancies in the first place.